This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Welcome to Dreamland. This is going to be a fascinating show. Of course, Dreamland is a fascinating show. But this week, we've got somebody very special. He's been on Dreamland 5 times over the years for a reason. He's one of the most interesting people in the world, I think. But he has not been on Dreamland since 2019. So 5 years now. And I'm going to be very happy in a moment to welcome back the chief scientist of the Institute for Noetic Sciences. He is an associated distinguished professor at the California Institute of Integral Studies. He's the co-founder and chairman of the biotech company Cognigenics. He earned an MS in electrical engineering and a PhD in psychology from the University of Illinois. And in 2022, was given an honorary Doctor of Science from the Vivekananda University in Bangalore, India. And as you may imagine, he's a terribly interesting human being. I want to welcome you, Dean Radin, to Dream Back to Dreamland.
Thank you.
Good to have you back again. Today we're going to be discussing something that I think might become quite important in the near future, because I see our planet as being in substantial trouble. And I do not see any really likely conventional ways of saving the situation. I think it's a very, very dangerous situation. But there are human powers that we ignore, that we in the modern world since the Enlightenment, the Renaissance, and then the Enlightenment have increasingly pretended don't exist. Dean Radin is an empowerer. He knows these do exist, why they work. And to a great degree, I think you know, Dean, how to re-engage with them. Let's start by talking about the cities and what they are. And I don't mean S-I-T-I-E-S, folks. I mean S-I-D-D-I-S. So, Dean, why don't you tell us a little bit about cities and what they are?
The cities are a name for what in the Western world we would call psychic abilities. The term comes from the yogic traditions, in which it was known for thousands of years that if you meditate diligently usually for quite a long time, that you will eventually reach a state that is called samadhi, which is a kind of mystical union with everything. And within that state, if you perform an additional practice called samyama, which is an intentional spin. I like to think of it as kind of you're in this state of unity with everything, and you put a little bit of intentional push that you can achieve all kinds of interesting things. So the most elementary city that is described among the 25 or so in the yogic literature is the ability to perceive past, present, and future all at the same time. So in Western terms, we might call that clairvoyance. We've done surveys with beginning meditators and asked them, what sort of psychic effects have you experienced? Anything from synchronicity to telepathy to precognition and so on. And roughly 75%, even of beginning meditators, will say, yeah, they occasionally have that ability, or at least have that experience. The difference in the yogic traditions is that you gain the knowledge of how to maintain those states. Now, for an average Westerner who is distracted constantly by cell phones and jobs and things like that, we generally don't have the hours per day that you need to devote to be able to enter samadhi at will. And even long-term meditators, they sometimes can't do it either. So it takes a certain degree of talent and practice to be able to achieve those states. But once you can do that and you can maintain samadhi for as long as you wish, you can start adding on these various kinds of siddhis, depending on what kind of intentional spin you put onto in within that state. So as I said, the elementary one is clairvoyance. More advanced versions we can call psychokinetic effects. So this is mind-matter interaction effects. And at very advanced stages, the yogic lore describes abilities that we would consider at this point to be like Superman, the ability to levitate, to fly, to have super strength, lots of things of that sort, that in the modern day, we don't see that. At least we've never seen it in the laboratory. That doesn't mean it doesn't exist. It might mean that in present day, that unless somebody is living in a cave for 30 years and is actually spending 12 hours a day in this kind of samadhi state, it's simply not something that we can see anymore. But you look back historically at these descriptions of the siddhis from thousands of years ago, why would they say a couple of them that we have been able to confirm in the laboratory and then make up a whole bunch of additional ones unless they were actually seen at that time? So I don't think they've gone away. These abilities have not dropped down from the sky. They've always been here, but it takes a combination of talent and, let's say, a level of extreme practice to be able to achieve them. And we're just, most of us are too distracted today by good reasons, as the ones that you began with, that the world is in a kind of a crisis and heading headlong into some other crisis. So it's hard to maintain this mental stability that's required in order to achieve these really super psychic abilities.
Let's go back to samadhi. Can you tell us a little bit about what the practice actually involves to get to this state that you...
Well, I think almost any meditative tradition would eventually get you there. I've done TM and various forms of non-local meditations. What generally works for me best is Vipassana, which is simply being aware of your breath. And if you do that for a while, you'll find that your thoughts begin to subside, and eventually you reach a state which is just awareness. It's awareness without any content, but you're aware, and you know that you're aware, but there's no thoughts anymore. It takes a while to get to that stage. That is close to samadhi. Samadhi is like a next step where you not only are aware, you're sitting there with awareness, but the awareness begins to expand. And so sometimes this is called a moment of spaciousness and timelessness. Your sense of space expands out to the end of the universe, and your sense of time becomes eternal. And so those are also spontaneously arriving effects or arising effects simply as a matter of practicing being in this state of pure awareness. And there's even further states. So there is no end to the degree to which you can achieve this kind of unity state with the rest of the universe. And one of the very interesting things about this is that you can achieve it through meditation. Is probably the gentlest and safest way to do it. Some psychedelics will get you there really fast, probably a bit too fast for most people, because then it's not controlled. But sometimes just looking at a beautiful sunset can spark it. Or as astronauts have often found, like the founder of our institute, sometimes looking at the Earth from space will spark that same kind of unity experience. So the other thing interesting about having this experience is that it almost always is transformative in a pro-social direction. And by that, I mean that people, wherever they started from, will become more compassionate, more empathetic, and more inclined to consider the needs and state of other people. So pro-social means you're doing things for the benefit of others. And so that's very interesting that this internal state of expansion leads to this beneficial behavior.
I had a couple of wonderful conversations with Edgar Mitchell about that moment in his life. And I think that I came away from it with the idea that his ego had disappeared during that moment. And that, and reading, I've been reading a book called They Flew, which you may be familiar with. I'm sure you are.
Yep.
And folks, this is a wonderful book about religious ecstatics in the late middle and early middle ages and early modern era. And there's something consistent about all of these people. And that is they entered states of ecstasy that completely obliterated their egos. Now, I'm not saying that ego is a bad thing, but it might be somewhat in the way of the of achieving the cities. And when we come back, Free Dreamlanders, we're going to find out what Dean thinks about that. We'll be right back.
Who are they? Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted? Them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, softcover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get Them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me.
We're talking to Dean Radin. His website, deanradin.com. You can find out about his books at deanradin.com, Real Magic and Supernormal being two of them. That we have discussed both of these books on Dreamland before, but quite a while ago. I'm sure you, most of you have not listened to those shows, but you can go back and listen to them if you're interested in, if you're a subscriber and interested in detailed information. So, tell us about this as we were leaving the taking the pause, just before we were taking the pause. Can you move on from there?
Well, you mentioned the book They Flew.
Yes.
And it's a very interesting book. It's talking about two types of effects that would elevate a religiously inclined person, at least within the Catholic faith, into sainthood. And one was levitation and the other was bilocation. So levitation, people are flying or hovering. And the other one, bilocation, that you would be seen simultaneously at two or more places at the same time, typically quite far apart. And so the book goes through at least a dozen, I don't remember how many, maybe two dozen cases of people, as you said, in medieval times, mostly in some more modern times, where people either levitated in the presence of lots of witnesses, hundreds in some cases, or bilocated, again, with credible witnesses being able to say that the person was in two places at the same time, or sometimes more than two places. Well, so yes. The interesting part about this book, as you can imagine, is that the person talking about this was a historian and a scholar, and starts the book by mentioning how challenging it is for a modern person, even somebody who studies history, to imagine that these things actually occurred, rather than that it was some kind of hallucination or hagiography or something like that. But nevertheless, he goes through these cases in great detail, and the reason why the title of the book is They Flew is because after a few hundred pages of enormous detail, he concludes with the final words of the book is, they flew. That's the best that you can come up with. Yeah, they really did fly.
Here's the fascinating thing about this. And, you know, I'm sure you knew Paul Eno, or at least somewhat. I knew Paul very well, fairly well. And he was a paranormal researcher, and he had started out as a novice in a Catholic, as a novice Catholic priest. And when he was a novice, he ended up assigned to the exorcist of the archdiocese he was in as his assistant. And he went to an exorcism at a mental institution, and accompanying him, there was another young man with him, the exorcist, a psychiatrist, two psychiatric nurses, and the patient who was diagnosed with a severe case of schizophrenia, and the family had asked to try an exorcism. She was sitting in a wheelchair. She was a 17-year-old girl, and these other people were all arrayed around the room. And in the middle of the exorcism, she comes floating up out of the wheelchair in front of everybody, in front of Paul. And the exorcist quietly says to Paul, "Push her back down." And he pushed her back down in the chair, and he was able to tell us on Dreamland exactly how that felt. And he said she felt like a toy balloon filled with helium. And there was not much resistance. And when she went down into the chair, he said, "I thought she was going to float back up, but she didn't." Now, let's talk a little bit about the science of this. Because I have been aware of the fact that we're made of water, mostly, and calcium. Neither of these things come anywhere close to floating in the air. So what in the world happens to the human body and the clothing? Because remember, these friars and nuns back in the Bay Flu era, they wore heavy wool habits, black shroud-like habits, and or dark brown and things, and they flew along with the individual, as is indeed happened in the mental institution. So here we are with an expert, folks. Dean, take it away. What do you think in the world could be going on here?
Well, this kind of phenomena doesn't make any sense at all with the prevailing scientific worldview, because it would require a change in gravity, a localized change in gravity that would require a gigantic amount of mass to distort space-time. And if you had that amount of mass to be able to cause somebody to levitate, it would probably destroy everything in the space of many miles. So that's not a viable explanation. So it requires a different kind of worldview. We're talking here about, if a philosopher would say, this is basic ontology. It's about what is the nature of reality? Well, scientific worldview is called materialism, and it assumes that everything is made out of matter and energy. And it has been a very successful way of thinking about the world. It's led to all kinds of wonderful advances. But it has left out something very important. It's left out our experience of awareness, the fact that we have any experience at all. And this is still a major problem within science. And more scientists, including neuroscientists and physicists, are beginning to recognize that maybe while materialism is quite a good way of thinking about the way the world works, it's not complete. We need a more comprehensive way of thinking about reality. This doesn't mean that we throw away materialism because it's too good. It works for the physical world really well. But what it does mean is that we need some more comprehensive way of thinking about the reality with a large R, where materialism is a special case. And so you can think of this like classical physics as a special case of physics, where quantum physics is a more comprehensive way of thinking about reality, as is relativity. So relativity works mainly in the space of very large distances and large mass and so on. and quantum mechanics generally in the world of the small. This is not entirely the case, but just you can think of it in that way. Whereas classical physics works in the everyday common sense world, more or less. So we don't throw away materialism. It's far too effective for the world of the everyday. But how do we then expand it? Because we need to expand even beyond quantum mechanics and relativity. And so we look at alternative worldviews that have come about. The worldview that we currently have is roughly 500 years old. The other worldviews that have been around for as long as humanity has existed, for tens of thousands of years, says that actually what is fundamental, truly fundamental, is consciousness. It is awareness. That's fundamental. That's what all of the Eastern esoteric traditions say, and Western esoteric traditions, including all of the yoga traditions. It's all about consciousness. And by saying that it's more fundamental than the physical world, suddenly that opens a huge range of possibilities. That where something like levitation, you would say, well, of course that's possible, because it's all basically, the physical world is predicated and emerges out of consciousness, out of the mind. So if somebody goes into a state of samadhi, or they get a siddhi, or they're in an ecstatic state, their mind is revising the laws of physics, because the laws of physics are coming out of the mind in the first place. So from that perspective, virtually everything that we think about having to do with the mind, and especially psychic effects related to the mind and special powers of the mind, all of that makes a lot of sense from what a philosopher would call an idealist position instead of a materialist position. And the beauty of this is that, as I said, the materialism as a doctrine, as a way of thinking about the world, is still perfectly valid. We're not going to throw away any textbooks. What we will do is add another chapter to many of the textbooks saying that, oh, by the way, this, what we're describing here is the way that things work, is really a special case. It's a very effective special case for studying certain things, but it doesn't account for everything. And when we expand, we begin to expand more into the nature of consciousness, and that begins to explain all sorts of things that were currently considered to be beyond the pale.
In the past, in Southern Europe, Catholic Southern Europe, and certainly in India for many thousands of years, and even up until the present, there's a very different experience of mind than we have in the West, in Northern Europe and North America and Australia, places like that, Japan, China, which are not in the West, but they're adopting the same mindset, I think. But there is, you said that we know that reality essentially comes out of the mind. And what has happened, I think, is we've kind of gone blind to part of what we are. And it never occurred to the medieval ecstatics to be blind to that. They thought it was Jesus or God lifting them up out of love for their piety. At least mostly that's what they thought. And they certainly hoped that the Inquisition, which took a great interest in these cases, thought that too. And, you know, and one of the reasons that this is so interesting and the makes They Flew such an compelling book is that the Inquisition did take such an interest and studied these cases with extraordinary care, and they were not delusional. One of them, Joseph of Cupertino, mentioned, even levitated in front of the Pope. The situation is this, folks. He's so excited. This guy is more religious than anyone you have ever, the most religious person you ever know. He's already got all kinds of wonderful capabilities and powers, which we'll talk about in a second. He kneels down to kiss the feet of the Pope and goes shooting up into the rafters instead. A moment of incredible excitement and ecstasy is what did that to him. Do we have any science that tells us or even points us in a direction as to how profoundly such a moment might change the entire body.
The closest that we have today about thinking of this is from quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics has done something very odd. And again, I need to use a few philosophical terms here. That there's epistemology and ontology. Ontology is the nature of being, the nature of how things exist. Epistemology is saying, how do we know what exists? So in the classical way of thinking about the everyday world, what you can know is separate from what exists. In fact, that's the way that you do science. You see some interesting thing, and you assume that by looking at it, the way that you know about it, it's not going to change that thing. And in most cases, in the everyday world, that's true. It's not so true with human behavior, because if you look at somebody else, it might change their behavior, but not if they don't know that you're looking at them. And it's lots of other things. You look through a microscope at some bug or something, it generally is not going to change its behavior simply because it's being looked at. But this is no longer the case when you look at quantum objects. Generally, we're talking about things like photons, particles of light, or atoms, things at that level. That what you know about those objects changes their behavior in ways that are actually fairly simple to measure. It's not understood, but it's well accepted in mainstream physics today that there is something called the quantum observer effect. And this is referring to the fact that when you observe a quantum particle, its behavior changes, its properties change from what they were before. And it's actually not quite true to say that they change. It's more radical than that. For a quantum particle does not have properties yet until you look at it. When you look at it, it gets properties, which is very, very strange, because there's nothing in the everyday world that we think of as an object that has no properties. But nevertheless, that's what happens in the quantum world. What this suggests is, and this is where you open the door just a crack into trying to understand a phenomenon like levitation, is that something about the nature of observation is changing an aspect of the physical world. It affects it directly. So that's the door. It's opened a crack. It's not opened to the point where we can say, well, that's why we can get levitation. But it does show that as science has progressed more and more into what we can think of as the micro world, the fundamental underpinning of the physical world, the stranger it becomes, and more importantly, the stranger it becomes in the direction of understanding why some of these strange effects like levitation might work, that it really does have something to do with the mind. Now, if you ask most physicists, they will say, no, these effects have nothing to do with consciousness. They can only say that if they ignore a couple of things that are also known in quantum mechanics, namely that the way of demonstrating this effect, this quantum observer effect, is with a double slit optical system. So you take a slide that has two tiny little slits in it, that's the double slit, then you shine a laser through the two slits, and then you have a screen on the other side that measures what sort of a pattern you get when you shine the laser through those two slits. So generally what you'll see is a interference pattern on the screen. You see bands of light and dark. Those bands can be predicted as though light was behaving like a wave. It's almost like exactly like water waves. That's what you get. But you could also do this with a single photon at a time. You shine just one photon to go through the two slits, and that will eventually show a pattern that looks like waves as well. And this is why we have the idea of the photon being both wave-like and particle-like. Well, where does the particle light come from? Well, you see a spot on the screen. You don't see a wave on the screen, but it behaves like a wave. So the observer effect comes in play if you put a detector behind one of the slits so you can measure which of the two slits it goes through. That's called getting which path information, because now you know, because of your detector, that it went through one of those slits. And now when you look at the pattern of light that you get on the screen, it's no longer an interference pattern of light and dark bands. It's just basically two bright bands. That's not exactly right because there's diffraction going on, but nevertheless, there is a significant difference when you know which path of information. observation than when you don't. So that's the quantum observer effect. It's physics 101. It's easy to demonstrate. So physicists would then say that the reason why this happens is because in the act of detecting the particle, you kind of force it to become a particle. And that's how you get the which path information, that you have forced it, you've constrained the wave-like behavior into a particle-like behavior. That's the conventional view.
So the universe is a hypothesis that becomes real only when it's recognized.
Only when it's observed. But more importantly, the meaning of observation is important to unpack, because if you believe that it's the detector that gives you the which path information, and that's the only thing that it can be, well, then that will lead you to the conclusion that the observer effect really has nothing to do with the mind at all. It has to do with the way you measure things, and there's a difference. You can measure something with a ruler and get a result, and that doesn't have a lot to do with the mind until you look at the result. But if you take a double-slit system and you put a detector behind one slit, and you shoot a single photon, it'll eventually hit the screen. And so if it goes through one of the slits with the detector, you know that because the detector makes a click sound, it tells you, and so you'll get a particle-like behavior. But if you shoot the photon and the detector does not click, but nevertheless hits the screen at some point, you know it had to go through the other slit. You still get a particle-like behavior, which is very strange because nothing hit the detector. This is called an interaction-free measurement. It didn't interact with anything, but you can infer that it must have gone through the other slit because it ended up hitting the screen, and you know that you shot one photon. So there's a variety of different ways of showing this in the laboratory, that it is not about the interaction with a physical device. It's about what you know. Well, who's you?
That's incredibly mysterious.
Yes.
In speaking of mysteries, folks, I'm going to solve one for you right now. If you're not a subscriber, the mystery is solved immediately. You're going to be watching some commercials. But if you are a subscriber, we're going to keep on keeping on. We'll be right back.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it. And I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion. Listen to it. Read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
We're talking to Dean Radin, his website, deanradin.com. You can engage with Dean there. Dean is out on the lecture circuit from time to time. You can learn about the Institute for Noetic Sciences, which has a wealth of fascinating programs. Believe you me, get into that. And you can learn about Dean's books as well. And they are very well worth reading. I cannot tell you how much I have enjoyed them. And obviously, I mean, he's highly knowledgeable. And let me ask you now, could we conceivably get to the point under the pressure that we are beginning to be under from this changing environment of ours, where we reconnect with these cities and begin to use them as tools, because they could be used as very powerful tools to affect nature and to affect human relationships, and which are going to be under tremendous stress soon. So tell us about that possibility, if you will.
So there's two things to say there. One is the Global Consciousness Project. This is looking at what happens when millions to billions of people are simply focusing their attention on the same thing at the same time. This is possible now because of the way that global media will carry events live, big events, like the opening ceremony of the Olympics. You might have a billion people watching. Well, does that do anything? I mean, other than the fact that it probably gets somebody revenue because a lot of people are watching a show, but does it change the physical world in any way? That's the question asked by the Global Consciousness Project. And if you go to the website gcp2.net, you'll end up at the second version of the Global Consciousness Project. So this is a network of truly random, physical-based random number generators that are just sitting there and producing random numbers all the time. And they call it truly because they're not a software algorithm, but an actual physical device that is producing randomness. And so it currently, with the GCP2, the second version of this network, there's something on the order of 300 devices, and each one of those has four separate random number generators in it. So there's over 1,000 of these devices around the world continually producing these random numbers. They all get sent up to a server. And the underlying question is that in cases, in unusual times when you have millions to billions of people that are doing the same thing at the same time, is there any change to the physical world? And so the reason why we use random number generators is because if you consider that a billion minds all paying attention to the same thing at the same time, in mental space, that's quite unusual. It means there's an enormous amount of coherence among lots and lots of minds. Well, up until fairly recently, we didn't have that capability of having billions of minds all doing the same thing at the same time. And this is, there's no intention here. There's simply people paying attention to the same thing at the same time. Well, it turns out that if you look at the data from these random generators, they become more coherent as well. And that suggests that there is some correlation going on between mind and matter, in this case, at a global scale. So this experiment came out of 50 years of prior experiments with one person and one random number generator to see what happens with randomness, a physical measure, when the mind is directed at a device that's producing the randomness. And the short story is, it changes. The randomness changes. It becomes less random. So that's one of many different ways of looking at the relationship between mind and matter. And this is relevant to the question that you just asked, because it suggests that if the world is going into some kind of crisis, which is a kind of high-level randomness, that if every single person in the world spent an hour a day meditating on peace and calm, that is very likely to happen. Of course, getting those people to all do that at the same time is a challenge. And maybe you don't need everyone in the world. Maybe you just need a couple million people every day doing this for hours a day. And would that affect the nature of the world itself? Well, these experiments suggest that the answer is yes. So we do have very good evidence, actually, that the correlation between mind and matter does seem to extend out to the world at large. And there are many other experiments, usually laboratory experiments, that suggest the same kind of event. Is there a way that mind could help ameliorate some of the crisis conditions that face us? I think the answer is yes. But there's a second side to this discussion. And that is that among the various kinds of abilities that we're talking about, we're just talking about mind-matter interaction, but another one is telepathy. And the evidence for telepathy is actually better than it is for mind-matter interaction. So this is gaining some knowledge about somebody else's mind.
I've experienced this myself. I've had moments of telepathy. So I'm convinced it exists, and I found it really upsetting, frankly, because it's happened a few times, and I'm with people, and suddenly I can hear not just the thoughts of the people I'm talking to, but the whole cacophony of everyone around me. And it at first I thought it was some kind of schizophrenic thing, but it was very obvious the second time it happened that it was not, that this was these people's inner material. I can't even put into words what some of it was, sounds like, because it's not like you're hearing a voice. It's very complicated, but go ahead.
So imagine that we got telepathy under control, because what you're describing does happen occasionally to people. It's that your mind becomes sensitive to the minds of other people, and it would be a cacophony, right? It's disturbing. It's overwhelming, right? So you can imagine then from an evolutionary perspective that maybe as simple organisms, we did have that capacity, but we very quickly would be weeded out of the evolutionary tree, because if your mind is overwhelmed by all these other minds, you'd become paralyzed. You can't be a useful organism. You couldn't even survive for very long.
Yeah.
So modern humans, these kinds of abilities have mostly been evolved away. They're still there, but they've been pushed deep into the unconscious. So most of the time, we don't actually experience this. But let's say science advances and we figure out ways of making something like telepathy very effective. You could turn it on and off when you wanted to, and you can focus on an individual when you wanted to. I think there are reasons to believe that we will eventually be able to do that. So now consider a world where there are no secrets, because suddenly anybody at any time is an open book. That is not the world we live in.
No. Well, I had that. That was part of the embarrassment of it was, you know, people were, I didn't even want to talk about it. It was very distressing.
Yeah. So to become a world where there are no secrets, the justice system changes immediately. The whole political arena changes immediately. That nobody can lie anymore because everybody immediately knows about it. Business would change. Everything that we think of as civilization of the modern era would change. It has to. So what then happens to all of the pressure that would occur from lots and lots of people in different positions of power today to say, don't do that. You know, don't develop a way to do that unless you keep it secret, which is like a paradox. It's okay for certain people to have this ability, like maybe somebody in the CIA, but it's not okay for everybody to have this ability.
Well, do you think that could already be the case? Because I've had the impression maybe it is.
I think that there are easier ways of not of looking into people's minds, but of surveilling. There are lots of methods of doing surveillance that don't require this level of mental acuity. I think it is possible in principle, but probably not. So, I mean, even remote viewing, for example, is called that because, like, you can get imagery of what's going on elsewhere, but it's not necessarily telepathic. You're not pulling things out of somebody's mind.
Yeah.
So could we use our inherent abilities to help solve the crises in the world, and even not even of the world, but of like interpersonal problems and so on? The answer is yes. And there are plenty of people who are psychic healers and so on that are already doing this. But it could be done in a large scale way. I suspect that at this point, we are not sufficiently mature as a species to be able to get to that point?
I wouldn't think so, because, for example, what happens to acting when everybody knows the person is acting? I mean, you can't be an actor like that. Or, God, politics.
Yeah,
they wouldn't have to say if they couldn't lie.
Yeah, that's why, politics would immediately change. Acting would not, because you can suspend your disbelief, just like when we go to the movies.
Of course, that's right. That's
So, but in the case of course, they're acting. I mean, that's part of the fun. But if somebody is like a politician and telling you outright lies, and you know immediately that they know that they're lying, well, that's one thing. If they don't know that they're lying, that's also very interesting to know, because now they're delusional. So, yeah, things would change very dramatically. And that's why, in my optimistic sense, I think, yes, science will eventually learn much, much more about these kinds of phenomena. At least we have the capacity to learn. But again, we come back into my more pessimistic sense and we say, are we advanced enough as a species to be able to do this? Well, it depends on whether we go extinct or not. So, this is always kind of a current possibility after the development of nuclear weapons. It could happen at any moment, in which case, well, science would stop if we're not here anymore, or if we revert back to the caveman era. But I think, again, put on my positive side, I think that we do have the capacity of learning a lot more about these kinds of phenomena, in which case we can go back to somebody like Joseph of Cupertino and say, well, how could he possibly have levitated in front of the Pope simply because he went into an ecstatic state? We will have a board full of equations at that point that say, well, this is how he did it. And part of those equations will have something to do with the mind, because it clearly is involved with the mind in some way. And eventually it will also say that what we used to call supernatural, which is referring to the divine, will have equations attached to that too. It doesn't mean the divine goes away, but it does mean we have a much better idea of what we're dealing with.
It'll be like Jeff Kripal says, two words, supernatural. Yeah. In other words, natural, but very powerful and very unusual.
Yeah. Advanced, yeah, in some way, yeah.
You know, Joseph, as you point out, I believe, if I'm not recall, I'm pretty sure I'm recalling this correctly in Real Magic, Joseph of Cupertino had other powers besides levitation that were extraordinary.
Yeah.
His ability, and this gets to telepathy, to see into the minds of other people,
yeah,
was scary. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, he was avoided by people who didn't want him to know what they were actually up to, because
because he
had an exceptional telepathic ability and could like see right through somebody. He can tell what they were up to. He also apparently had a healing ability. He could heal and he could hurt, both. So you can see then why, from the Inquisition's perspective, he was essentially a very powerful witch.
Yes.
He had the very strong abilities that we would associate with someone like a magician or a witch. And fortunately, he was well ensconced within the Catholic Church. And within the Catholic Church, there are many rituals which are basically magical rituals. The Eucharist is just one example. So it's okay. The magic is okay, but only if it's done by certain people in certain contexts. And he was very lucky that the Inquisition decided that, okay, he seems like he's still remaining within the confines of the church, and he's not trying to tell people he's the new Jesus, because if he did that, he would have been killed for sure.
Yeah.
So he was, as many people learned at that time, that if you have these abilities, do not demonstrate them outside of the confines of the church, because it'll kill you.
Yeah, and they used to do that a great deal, and during the mid 17th century, I believe, is when he lived, during the height of the witch burning business. So,
right,
it was a dangerous time to have powers like this, especially powers you couldn't really control, because he would. Or another one is sister. Is it Mary of Agreda? Yes, who was, she was a convent nun who bilocated to New Mexico and converted Indians to Christianity before the conquistadors came and burned them all at the stake for not being Christians. But she also was a levitator. And when she levitated, she went into a complete, like a medium's trance state. In other words, she had no relation. It was just black as far as she was concerned. And she was so light and floating in the air that the other nuns discovered that they could actually move her around a room just by blowing on her. And they brought her out into their courtyard when she was like this and made people pay to come in and blow her around and things. And when she found this out, of course, she was being made into a kind of an exhibit A, she was furious. But let's go on with some other cities that could be of great value to us. The ability to move objects. Now, this is one that we know is real because it was enacted and used by Ed Leedskalnin in the creation of the Coral Castle in Florida, just in the 20th century. And he, you know, I've studied that extensively. I've been to been there, and I've read everything there is to know about. I've even interviewed someone about this on Dreamland, and it was real. He didn't use a system of pulleys and stuff. He did it at the quarry and again at the site, but moving the things from the quarry to the site, he said it was ancient Egyptian magic. Huh. And then you look at something like the platform at Baalbek, 100-ton stones that we could not move today. And you think to yourself, what have we lost? Did we have these in the past, Dean, do you think?
Well, as you said, there are some contemporary stories that suggest that we haven't lost it. Maybe it...
But we have lost our ability to believe it and or to use it on a huge scale.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we've been told since the time of the Inquisition that this kind of thing is demonic unless it's done within the constraints of a certain belief system, in that case, Catholicism. We should remember that the Catholic Church got into trouble around the time of the Reformation because it was considered to be corrupt. And so the Protestant Reformation, among other things, at that point said, all this supernatural stuff that the church is doing is nonsense. It's dangerous and it's nonsense.
Yeah, and it's there to put money in the hands of the priests,
basically. Yeah, it's a corrupting influence. And so you have pressure both from the religious side and also on the scientific side for hundreds of years, saying this stuff is somewhere between demonic and delusional. And so in the academic world today, and of course it's spread out everywhere in the educated world, it is saying that this stuff doesn't exist. Because if it's demonic, which many scientists probably would not accept, but some would, or if it's delusional, which is generally what academic psychologists believe, then why would you even pay any attention to it? These things are simply entertainment and stories. So anyone who's gone through an educational program in the developed worlds, which is a lot of people, come out after 20 some years or however many years have been going to school with the notion that this stuff is nonsense. And so they either are unaware of the fact that there's over 150 years of science actually that addresses these topics, parapsychology, or they know about parapsychology and they dismiss it because they say, well, it's a pseudoscience because we know this stuff isn't real. Yeah. So both of those positions are wrong, of course, because if you do look at the literature, you find out pretty quickly that at least some of the elementary psychic abilities that come down through thousands of years of legends and the Siddhis, we know that they're real. We know they're real by the same tools and techniques that are used in other scientific disciplines. So the reason why there's this taboo, and the taboo is sustained, is partially, as I was mentioning before, that if we develop methods that were able to replicate the stories of magic of old, that would be perceived as a threat, a gigantic threat against individuals, against governments, against all kinds of people in power. And that's why I suspect that this kind of work is tolerated because it's interesting, but there's also pressure to make it not too powerful.
Well, yeah, I mean, I can imagine governments would be quite upset if the general public had telepathy. That would be hard for them, and not to mention criminals and sex perverts and anybody who has got something to hide, basically.
Right.
Bankers, I presume. I want to go back, though, to I don't want to belabor it, but I want to go back to one of the cities, to levitation, for a particular reason. I wanted to discuss Daniel Douglas Hume, and because we were talking about this in the context of religious ecstasies, and the implication I fear arose that you have to have some kind of ecstatic state in order to enact these cities. And can you tell us, Hume is a very interesting character. Can you tell us a little bit about him? And he was not a religious ecstatic at all. So tell us a little bit about this extraordinary story.
So this was during the beginning, the heyday of spiritualism, with things like table tipping and seances and that sort of thing. Hume, actually, I had spelled Hume, but I believe it was, he pronounced it Home, Daniel Douglas Home. Anyway, he, like other physical mediums, is what they were called. So a medium is a person who holds a seance. But the physical medium is holding a seance where various kinds of psychokinetic effects come about. In fact, they were called telekinetic events because big things moved, telekinetic. Whereas psychokinetic is more like mind-matter interaction. These are slightly different terminology, but it's the same thing. So Home was able to, in his seances, make very large things happen. So initially the table might tilt a little bit, but then the table would actually rise up over above ground. It would levitate and sometimes dance around the room. And you'd have men trying to hold it down and they can't hold it down. And then eventually he would start levitating too. So lots of witnesses, lots of different contexts, skeptics watching him, hundreds and hundreds of people saw him levitate as well. So he apparently was not in a religious ecstatic state. He had, apparently from his biography, from a young child, was able to show these kinds of abilities. That suggests that there's something like a genetic talent for this sort of thing. The interesting thing about Home is that he had been studied by thousands of people, including a lot of skeptics. This was mostly taking place in Europe at the time. And nobody was ever able to prove that he was doing fraud. No one. So in the realm of people doing physical mediumship, even to the present day, most of the cases, I would say, most cases involve fraud in some way, one way or another. Maybe a medium wasn't always being fraudulent, but most have been caught in one way or another doing something that is considered fraud. So that's why he was so unusual. Huge effects seen by thousands of people, including skeptical magicians, and were never able to show that it was fraud. Well, that's pretty impressive.
Yeah.
But so what made him different? Again, I think it has to do with there's certain people have talents for these kinds of abilities. This, by the way, is also said by Tibetan monks who spend their entire lives meditating. Some of them will achieve the siddhis and some of them won't. In fact, a small number of people will achieve the siddhis. Most won't, even if they spend 30 years doing meditations, they still won't. So some people are different. Well, not everybody goes to the Olympics either. So, you know, there are different predilections and abilities that people have. So it shouldn't surprise us too much that it is found in this realm as well. So apropos, we've done a study that we call Psygenes, where we've looked at the folklore of these kinds of abilities running in families, because you find this folklore in every culture, and it goes all the way back as far as we can look. And that suggests that there's a genetic component to this. So we did a what's called a case control study, where we got the DNA from people that we vetted had actually had psychic talent, who said that they come from families who had this talent. And then we compared them against people who did not have any psychic talent, against families that also didn't have any psychic talent, to look for some kind of genetic difference between them. And so it's quite a small study, but we were still surprised that we did find a significant difference in the genetics of people with and without psychic talent. It was opposite from what we had originally thought. We thought, and this was a very small study, so maybe it's simply not enough data yet, but even with the very small study that we did, we assumed that we would find that the talented psychics were essentially mutants, like X-Men, that they had some special genetic structure that was different. What we found instead is that it was the controls, the ones who didn't have any psychic ability, they were different. And so one of the people involved in our study is a specialist in the genetic of populations. Like each country will have slightly different changes in their genes overall. And so he found that there's a historical connection with the controls that had no psychic ability that pointed back to a certain portion of the world. And when you think about this, it is not too surprising that it pointed back to what used to be called the Holy Roman Empire. Why? We're talking about people who don't have psychic ability, because the Inquisition did its job really well. And it found people who had these abilities and got rid of them.
And killed them off.
And changed the genetic constellation of what you see in those portions of the world.
That is absolutely horrifying. They crippled us.
Well, fortunately, they didn't.
Legs and arms.
Yeah. They changed the genetic composition of an entire population. Yeah.
Oh, my God. That is really one of the scariest things I've ever heard in my life. But not every population, because the Holy Roman Empire, after all, it's the same. The same can't be true of England.
No. So they didn't know about the Druids very much then. They didn't know about the Celtic population and many other populations around the world, where these kinds of abilities were better accepted, and more importantly, were not under the thumb of the Catholic Church at the time. So it still is the case that people identified as witches in less developed countries are still at risk of losing their life. But
that happens in Africa all the time.
Yes. So fortunately, in the more developed countries, you might be shunned, or if you're lucky, you'll become a healer or something, and then you'll earn a living doing that.
Well, I know a physical medium in England, Stuart Alexander, who's been on this show. I was just in his seance 2 weeks ago, and it's a weekly seance. It's private. He doesn't do it publicly much at all. And there's no money involved. It's just that happens in a private home in a little town in England. And it's a group of people who've been doing it for 40 years together. Mm-hmm. And I saw spirit trumpets levitate. I saw all kinds of things happen in there. And it just comes out through Stuart. It's something to do with his body and his mind. And it took him many, many years of concentrating, basically what he calls concentrating, to get to the point where spirit would come through him and he would get into a deep trance. And then all of these other manifestations began to occur around him. Mm-hmm. And they're quite real. I mean, they're not, it's not sleight of hand or anything. So this is true and it's real. And, you know, I would like you to, when we're off the air, and I'm going to put this up on the show description, to send me a link or whatever you have about that study of people who had lost these abilities, because sure. That's important that our listeners understand that. I think it's important to everybody.
Yeah. So we have a published article on this. I'll send you the link to it.
Oh, excellent. Well, Dean, I said an hour, and we've gotten to an hour, and it seems like about 5 minutes. It's just been so much fun and so informative and revealing. Dean's website is deanradin.com. Visit the Institute of Noetic Sciences website. You can link to it through Dean's website. And you can also look at Dean's books and his appearances. Do this. Get into this, because you are living, like I was living for many years, under the assumption that I don't have any of this. Most of you, most of us, have it all. Let's build some real, fully realized human beings here. And that, to me, means a human being who is in command of these extraordinary abilities known as siddhis, or achievements, or perfections. We can do it. Thank you, Dean.
You're welcome.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers.
Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.